Thank you all for giving me a chance to share with you this morning a little bit of this last 7 years of teaching mindful leadership. And I like to start by telling you a little bit of how I'm standing here, because sometimes, oftentimes, just before I take to the stage for things like this, I have these moments of, how did this happen? I was an NYU law grad. What am I doing here? How did this work? And I didn't start Buddhism when I was a teenager, and I'm not a Buddhist. So what am I doing here? So my journey, I have to take you back to the turn of the century, to the beginning of this century. I'm not that old. I have moments, but not yet. I was a 21st century juggler, like maybe most of you in this room or many of you in this room. So in the air, I was a spouse, married to my college sweetheart, still happily married. I was a mother of school-age children. I was juggling being a vice president and deputy general counsel of a Fortune 200 company, General Mills. I had aging parents, and I was the president of a board of a large nonprofit in the Twin Cities. So I was busy juggling. And most days, I sort of felt like I was doing what I was supposed to be doing. In fact, I was doing a lot of doing. I was very busy. My schedule was more than packed. But it seemed like I was getting through the day, more or less. And then one day, at the turn of the century, I was called down to the CEO's office, and I was told that General Mills would be acquiring Pillsbury. And it was going to be my job to lead the team responsible for getting FTC clearance of that deal. Now, as I said, I started here in New York with a large firm learning corporate law and strategy. And so doing a deal wasn't new to me. This was going to be a very big deal because it was essentially an acquisition of equals. But it was a deal, and we sort of expected that it would take 4 or 5 months. But on top of all my juggling, this was now a new ball to juggle, and a pretty big one. Well, as it would turn out, this deal would be the deal from hell. And instead of 5 months, it would actually take nearly 18 months to close this deal, to get this deal through. And the reasons for that and the people at the FTC is the subject of a whole other workshop, so we're not going to get into the details, except to say that these were 12 to 14 hour days that were stretching the limit of absolutely everything I had, physically, emotionally, intellectually. And it was day in, day out. So eventually, about 6 months into the deal, I vividly remember walking from my car into the office and being stopped by one of the Pillsbury officers and being asked about how the latest meetings in DC went. And I told him we had yet another slew of requests and questions and more that had to be produced. And he nodded his head and he said, well, you know, if you're not able to get clearance for this deal, 10,000 Pillsbury employees are likely to lose their job. Now, I didn't need any more incentive to work hard, but this was something else that I started to carry, and it was a weight that I felt. I didn't want 10,000 families affected. About another month after that conversation, as it would turn out, my mother, who was ill, passed away. And amazingly, 6 months after that, still within this 18-month window, I would be planning a memorial service for my father, who died unexpectedly. So in this 18 months, there was a period where my resiliency, physically, mentally, was gone. Finally, the deal got through. Finally, I had some time to grieve for my parents. And my work schedule, my juggling act, sort of went back to normal, and what it was before. But I didn't feel the same. I didn't feel as though I bounced back. And that's what I was after. So I wasn't on any huge spiritual journey here. I just wanted to bounce back. What I would learn later from some of my neuroscience colleagues is that when you get to a place where your resiliency is so, so depleted, your ability to bounce back is really limited. Luckily, I had a good friend who was also a physician, and his prescription was, you need to go away somewhere. You need to go to a spa. At that point in my life, with all those things juggling, I didn't go to spas a lot. And of course, during this 18 months, I actually had to send my family on vacation without me once because we were at that critical spot. So can you imagine going home at this point and saying, all right, kids, my sweet husband, I'm going off on vacation to a spa without you. That's not happening either. But this friend was very insistent and felt that really what I needed was go somewhere, have somebody take care of you, eat good food, get a lot of sleep, and you'll feel better. And he kept sending me the Zagat surveys. Here's the number one rated spa. And so he sent one day on a particular tough night where I still wasn't sleeping well and I dragged myself into the office. We all know what that's like. And I opened up the link and here was this place. It looked like heaven. It was just an amazingly beautiful place. I still couldn't get myself to go to the spa. But on the side, there was this little description of a special program that described a training of the mind called mindfulness. And it was taught by some guy named Jon Kabat-Zinn. And I started to look into who Jon Kabat-Zinn was because the description of training the mind was not a foreign idea to me. I actually had a father who believed that you could, in fact, train your mind. His way was through things like calculus and training your mind in that way. So the idea of training your mind wasn't that foreign to me. But I wanted to see who he was, not a New Agey type. So when I looked into that and found out, oh, he's an MIT-trained microbiologist. By the way, he's not a psychologist, which he often gets dubbed as. He's an MIT-trained microbiologist, and he, in fact, was the guy who created this mindfulness training. And I thought, went home, spoke with my family. They wholeheartedly supported it, and I went away. I'm sure they didn't want me in the state I was in either. So I went away. I will tell you that even up to this day, and that was a lot of years ago now, 13 years ago, I count that six-day event as one of the 10 hardest things I've ever done in my life. For me, after going at 150 miles an hour for 18 months with the loss of my parents in the midst of that, it was like hitting a brick wall. So, but that was the beginning of my exposure to mindfulness. I would study with many people after that time and was also a closet meditator for a good number of years. But what I started to notice when I came back to General Mills and my responsibilities there was that my other real love in my life was the development of leadership excellence. And what I started to see was the impact of this training of the mind and its intersection with some of the ways in which we develop leaders. And after a few years, I also started to notice the many, many opportunities among my colleagues and friends at General Mills where I thought this training of mindfulness would make a big difference in their lives and in the decisions that were being made. So I'd like to share a little bit more with you about that story and that journey, that while it started at General Mills, by 2008, my colleague Saki Santarelli from the Center for Mindfulness and I developed the first Mindful Leadership Retreat. In 2006, initially all of the training was just for General Mills. By 2008, we opened the retreats up to leaders from around the world. By the end of 2010, the demand had grown so large that we knew that this work demanded its own nonprofit. I left General Mills at the end of 2010 and founded the Institute for Mindful Leadership, and that's the work that I do with my colleagues there full time now. So a little bit about that journey and what we've learned over the years. We'll be looking today very quickly. Actually, I'm going to skip the definition of mindfulness. This is a very educated crew. I don't think I have to do that. But I will share with you something that I do when I'm talking to groups that don't know about mindfulness in organizations. I'm also going to tell you what our definition is of a mindful leader. What are we talking about? We're going to look specifically at can training the mind cultivate excellence and how does it work? I'm going to invite you to try a little bit of mindful leadership training for yourself and then hopefully answer some of the questions around how do we bring this to an organization. So this is what I share with folks to begin with, who aren't familiar with mindfulness. Here's what it isn't, because there's a ton of information out there and a million things that say what it is or what it claims to be. It's not a religion. It's not New Agey. And I like to reassure corporate types especially that we won't be chanting and we won't be burning incense. it's not about emptying the mind. So if we think we're going to stop thinking when we do this, that's not what's happening. If anybody knows how to do that, please let me know. I'd love to know how to do that. And it's not about achieving relaxation. And I think Barry already said that. It's, you know, the beginning, you might touch that place when you actually stop, when you actually begin to settle. You might feel that sense of relaxation. But mindfulness and mindful leadership training is not about achieving relaxation. It's about something much bigger. And they were on the panel with David and Jeff and Barry. They were talking about a million questions. But it isn't about, as we look at it, it isn't about a narrow piece of it. It's about becoming more of who we are. Just as we know we have innate abilities of our physical body that we can train and be stronger and be more flexible, we have innate capabilities of our mind that today, especially with all the connectivity, we need to develop, we need to train. And when we do so, in the context of thinking of each of ourselves as leaders, we find what I call the win-win-win. Good for the organization, whether it's a for-profit, non-profit, academic, good for the individuals in the organization, and good for the community, the larger picture. Okay, so this, of course, you all know, non-judgmental, moment-to-moment awareness. That's the mindfulness definition we use at the Institute. It's a common one. I often, when I talk to groups, I am mindful or am I? And it's useful here to talk about really simple examples when you're talking to a group, like, I'm mindful, really? I think I'm doing this all the time. Well, let's talk about sitting at your desk listening to a conference call. And you're just going to clear some of that spam mail while you're listening. Yeah, of course, you all know, right? Doesn't happen. The myth of multitasking. But let's turn now to what's the definition of a mindful leader? This picture, by the way, is the most recent graduates from our mindful leadership retreat. And in this picture, as they look at it, there are people here from Germany, Korea, Africa, Canada, and the United States. So a mindful leader embodies leadership presence, but how? Let's be more specific. Let's not stay at 40,000 feet. How does a mindful leader embody leadership presence? They cultivate what we call the fundamentals of leadership excellence. The first one is focus. So I hear from people all the time, and I just recently had a call from a dean of a very good business school where this dean was saying, can you come and help? Because the MBAs can't stay attentive long enough to do the reading. We have lived in a land of continuous partial attention for so long that when we need to sustain attention, we're not able to do it. So part of the training is how do we attend? How do we stay focused when we need to? Clarity. I saw this one all the time. I still see this in my own life and in people around me. Clarity. How do we help our leaders, all of us, because we're all leaders, how do we help our leaders stay in a present to see what's actually here? So how often are mistakes made because we see what we want to see? We see what we thought would be here, or what we wanted to be here, what we hope to be here. How is it that we begin to use this training to start to see our own filters, to start to see our own conditioning? Creativity. About 2 years ago, I was asked to work with a group who are identified by this company as the people from around the world in all their offices, who were called together for a period of a year to do innovation. That's their whole job, innovate. And I was asked to work with this group. And I started off by saying to the group, you can't think innovation. Now, for some people who aren't involved in innovation, you might think, well, that's how you innovate. You think a lot. But in fact, to this group, who was charged with innovation, who'd spent it, they all nodded their heads. That's right. You can't think innovation. Where does real innovation, where creativity, where does it come from? It comes from the spaciousness in the mind, the imagination. It comes from being able to clear the incessant to-do list, the constant thinking, having those moments of spaciousness. Can mindfulness training help us cultivate that spaciousness? And the last one, but not the least one, is compassion. So we're cultivating focus, clarity, creativity, and compassion. When we get to compassion, we have to start with self-compassion. because in my experience in more than 25 years of leading organizations, for-profit and non-profit, that's where it has to start. And most of the time, we are really bad. That long to-do list, that long caregiver list, we're way at the bottom. So we start with self-compassion, but it's also compassion for those around us, our colleagues, our family, our friends, and then it's compassion for that bigger picture. Remember the win-win-win? Compassion for the community in which we all live and work. So this is our definition of a mindful leader. When we embody leadership presence in the service of others, we are leading with excellence. Okay? When we embody leadership presence in the service of others, we're leading with excellence. Whether we're leading our own lives, a team, a classroom, a family, or a multi-billion dollar company. This is what we mean at the Institute when we talk about leading with excellence. We embody leadership presence in the service of others. We lead with excellence. So now, what do you know about leadership excellence? And I'd like to invite us to have a little taste of what mindful leadership training is right now and see if we can collectively decide what we know about leadership excellence. Not in some, what did the latest leadership book I read tell me it was, but what do you know about leadership excellence? So not to put any pressure on the group, but I've done this inquiry with groups all around the world, including the World Economic Forum last January. We always come up with a really fabulous definition, so you have a high standard to reach, but I have great confidence that we'll do this. So if you could, and if you care to, put everything in your hands down on the floor. Okay. And with your feet flat on the floor, so uncrossing your legs if you would. And if it's okay for you, if you're comfortable with it, if you would just allow your eyes to close or a soft gaze on the floor or on the chair ahead of you. So just taking a moment right now, sitting and knowing that you're sitting. So perhaps feeling the pressure of the legs pushing down on the soles of the feet, or the back of the legs in touch with the chair. Perhaps in this moment you're noticing a sense of warmth or coolness in the body, bringing the attention to the sensations that are here in the body, just as they are. Allowing those sensations to begin to concentrate the mind, resting into the awareness of sensations. Bringing a sense of openness and curiosity to simply notice, nothing to change. Just notice what sensations are here for you. Perhaps noticing the beat of the heart or the sensations of the breath. Noticing if the mind becomes distracted, pulled away, and seeing if you can escort it back to simply being present to the sensations in the body. And as you're ready, I'd like to invite you to call to mind someone who you know, who you have worked for or with, or even just someone you've read about and studied, a leader that you would say leads with excellence. I'd like you to call that person to mind and allow their image to come into the mind's eye just as with as much detail as you can, just bringing that person to mind. And it doesn't need to be a leader from your workplace. It could be a leader in your family, in the community. It can even be a historical leader. Someone that fits your understanding of leading with excellence. And as this person comes into your mind, asking yourself the question, simple question, why? Why did this person come to mind? What is it about this person that made you bring this person to mind when asked the question about leadership excellence? And allowing space for something more to arise in response to that question, just holding that question again lightly. No need to do a lot of analytical thought here. Just allow the answer to arise. Why do I think this person leads with excellence? What is it about their leadership? And as you're ready, opening your eyes. And just popcorn out answers, if you would. The word or phrase that came to mind when you asked yourself the question, why did this person come to mind when I brought to mind someone with leadership excellence?
Inspirational.
Inspirational, loving.
Compassion.
Expansiveness. Authentic.
Humility.
I'm sorry?
Expansiveness.
Humility. Inclusive.
Beneficial.
Accountable. Creates community. Joy. Caring, sets a good example.
Curious.
Integrity.
Good listener.
Contributor.
Trustworthy.
Courage. Goodness. Enjoyed what they're doing. Empowering. Humorous. Optimistic. Authentic. Great. Great, great, great. All good answers. You've all done very well. You've held your own. All right, so in the 7 years that I've been doing this kind of reflection with groups like this, it's always curious to me that the things that don't get mentioned are met the quarterly numbers. Worked well with the board. Okay, those things don't ever get mentioned anywhere in the world. All right. All these things that were mentioned roll up into two abilities. Your capacity to lead with excellence is directly related to these two abilities, and you've all mentioned them. They all roll up into these two things in my experience. Your ability to connect to yourself, others, and the community. Your ability to lead with excellence directly related to your ability to connect. And your ability to skillfully, the word here it's important is skillfully, initiate or guide change. Your willingness to be responsive, to hold ambiguity, even when the to-do list is miles long and you just want to check the box to get it off your desk. Collaborative, we heard a lot about that. Respectful, creative. These are the two abilities. And if we go ahead and dive a little more deeply into this in our land of continuous partial attention and this training of the mind that we're talking about, we see that the fundamentals of leadership excellence are directly supportive of your ability to connect. So your ability to focus, to listen deeply when you need to be creative, to have clarity about what's here, and to embody compassion. These are the fundamentals from our definition of mindful leader that support your ability to actually connect in the midst of the chaos, to actually see clearly so that you can be skillful in initiating change, to access that spaciousness for creativity, and to embody the kind of compassion that serves inclusiveness and collaboration. We heard this morning already that the movement is starting. And here's a sampling of the organizations who I have had the great privilege of teaching leaders from all of these organizations. This is a sampling. So they are both business and academic and nonprofit. And it has been an incredible joy and pleasure to work with organizations. And having said that, I will tell you that there is a very long way to go. And so a little bit about how we bring mindful leadership training and how you might bring it to your organization. We heard a little bit about a question of where do you bring it in? Is it a grassroots? Does it have to be the CEO? When I chose where to bring it into General Mills, I was very planful about it. In my experience in organizations, the people who, and I'm going to upset all kinds of people, including my colleagues at General Mills, but the people who actually do the work and influence the organization the most is the vice president and director level. It's not the C-suite, and it's not the grassroots. So very intentional and planful about where we started this. And when I started it, it was not an HR. So to that point, this was never an HR program at General Mills. And sometimes it is now for the other organizations I work with. Oftentimes it's not. It's someone who comes first to a retreat with a couple of people and then goes back and becomes the champion that works with the Institute to bring it more broadly. So mindful leadership retreats at General Mills, I'll just say one more thing about that. What happens when you start there is leaders do what good leaders do. So when they're touched by this, the very first thing that happened within a month of the first retreat, which was 13 people, 13 officers and directors, we stopped counting when it topped 500. And we're talking about intensive training and mindfulness. So first thing that happens within a month, good leaders do what good leaders do. They came to me and said, I want my division to learn this. I can't send them all off for a four-day retreat. How do we keep the integrity and the intensity without having to do it? And what was born very quickly after the first retreat was Mindful Leadership and Wellness course, which is appropriate for all levels, and it's a seven-week course done in the workplace, including a day of silence in the workplace. On a Saturday. Hey, you can't expect miracles, all right? All right. I'll tell you what, though, just so another, and I'm going to run out of time, I know, but when you do a day of silence in a workplace on a Saturday, the insights that arrive on Monday morning when you return to that place are dramatic and wonderful. So a little plug for that. All right, so mindful leadership retreats, these are typically for experienced leaders, and they're either organization specific. So I've had some organizations that say, I just want my team to be there. You know, I'm going to send you 20 people and I just want it to be specific to what we're looking for, what we're after. And then I've had others who like the idea that their leaders go to our open retreat where you're with leaders from around the world learning this. And then courses and workshops, these are mindful leadership and wellness courses. My colleagues and I at the Institute, all of the teachers that work for the Institute have both pieces. They're experienced leaders, entrepreneurs, pharmacists, IS people, lawyers, and they have deep practices. So they have been had both and brought them together and then trained in this mindful leadership curriculum for at least 2 years. So we spoke a little bit about that. I think one point I'd say about how do we teach more people, I'm not sure that the answer is trying to rush teachers. It may be to find the models where you can teach more people at one time with breakouts. So I think that may be, at least as I look at it, an opportunity to reach more people as the demand is growing. And then the courses I mentioned, there are seven-week courses. They're done live or virtual, and that's another way that you can reach people. So we've had virtual courses where people from around the country are in the same course. And then sometimes we do introductory workshops, which are 1 or 2 day trainings, but they are introductory, and we only will do that if there's going to be an opportunity for people who want to get more training, because we don't spend time doing, okay, here you go, have a nice day, and then that's the end. The other very important part to our work at the Institute is to be there for the journey. When you're not dealing with people who are coming to this because they're sick, or they're not able to handle their work, or they have some other pain issue, and you're dealing with people who basically feel themselves successful, their ability to make changes in their life really needs support. And so for the last 7 years, we have had both annual alumni retreats, where you can come back for a three-day refresher and deepening, and we also have online support for anyone who's gone through mindful leadership. I think that's an integral part to teaching this when you bring it into organizations. Otherwise, it's a nice weekend, and I go back to my regular life. This is a quote by Madeleine Albright that I think sums up how we work and how I feel about this. There are opportunities everywhere for every one of us to be leaders, and the capacity for leadership is deep within us. Thank you. I do have a book coming out, and I hope I'm happy to take questions for a minute or so here now. And if not, please feel free to get me later in the day or contact us. Yes?
Do you teach anywhere in the New York area?
I do. It wasn't. I never really. Yes. My next retreat is in October. There's only two spots left at the end of October, and it's in New York. At the Garrison Institute for my Garrison people. Any other questions? All right. Was there a question? No. Okay. Thank you.